Svako jutro ovi vojnici dižu grčku zastavu nad svojom drevnom citadelom, Atenskom akropolom. Ona seže 2500 godina unatrag, u doba kad je Atena izrodila ideju grada kojim upravljaju slobodni građani.
Athens is one of the most beautiful cities in the world. And in many ways, it's Athens that gave us our ideal of a city, our ideal of a citizen. We live in a modern world full of great cities. Modern Athens is far larger than Athens was in antiquity. And yet, the Athens of antiquity is an extraordinary achievement.
Nije to bilo mjesto gdje se stanovnici okupljaju oko kraljeve palače, nego sjedište otvorene vlade. Građani su upravljali svim oblicima svakodnevnog života, od obrane grada do odlaganja otpada. Na kraju je taj sustav odredio način života. Atenski građani dali su mu i ime. Nazivali su ga narodna vlast. Demokratija. Demokracija. Ovo je priča o tome kako su Grci pretvorili ideju grada u model koji živi i dan danas.
The colonists arrived here and so this is it and then we'll build everything around it.
The grid is coming into view.
Kako su stvorili urbani način života.
I love the fact that you know the names of the stonemasons, like the guys who carved the fluting.
Prvi ustav odredio je prava građana i izgradio grad kojem je cijeli svijet zavidio.
The Athenians were fighting for an ideal, and that's the ideal we articulate today.
Zatim ću otputovati u Rim, gdje su 500 godina poslije stvorili ono što ćemo nazvati prvim antičkim velegradom, u kojem je čak bilo i visoke gradnje.
What I love is that this isn't just a bit of archaeology. It's a bit of living history.
I podzemnih kompleksa.
E siamo proprio sotto il foro.
I nevjerojatne infrastrukture. Gradnja antičkog grada, Atena i Rim.
There's a famous passage in a guidebook written in the 2nd century AD by a Greek called Pausanias, and it's a guidebook to all of Greece. And he comes across a little place in Boeotia called Panopes. And he says, the city, the polis of Panopes. And then he pauses and says, if you can really call this place a polis. And what worries him about Panopes is, and I'll give the quote, it has no magistrates buildings, no gymnasium, no theater, no agora, not even a water supply leading to a fountain.
Javni prostori, javne građevine, kazališta, poslije čak i javne knjižnice kao što je ova, to su bili elementi za koje su Atenjani znali da pretvaraju mjesta masovnog stanovanja u pravi grad. U Ateni su ih smatrali samorazumljivima i to je postavilo mjerilo za sve drevne mediteranske gradove, ali i za gradove današnjice. Ta su velika očekivanja bila proizvod sustava vlasti koji je Atena podarila svijetu. Vladavina naroda, kojom narod vlada za narod. A to se dogodilo ovako. Mnogi misle da je engleska Magna Carta iz 1215. bila prvi ustav. No, dokument koji ću vam pokazati bilježi ustav iz 6. stoljeća prije nove ere. Gotovo 2000 godina prije Magne Carte. Atenski ustav Athenaion Politeia napisao je veliki grčki mislilac Aristotel, a za razliku od Magne Carte, do sad još nije snimljen kamerom.
Is this it? Oh wow. Isn't this fantastic? I've so often seen pictures of this, but this is the first time I've seen this in the flesh. It's a papyrus that's, well, it's 2,000 years old, but it's the only surviving copy of Aristotle's Constitution of Athens. It was discovered back in 1890. It came to the British Museum, and the very, very young Frederick Kenyon, 27 years old, he set about reading it. The Greek is incredibly hard to read. This is just a bit of it. This is half the papyrus. The full thing would go down to here. It's 7 foot in all. And there were 4 of those scrolls. And this initial bit is where he tells the first chapter, which is about the reform of Solon. Here, for instance, there's Solon himself, Solon.
Atenjani su Solona smatrali osnivačem svoje demokracije. Proglasili su ga zakonodavcem i pozvali ga da napiše novi zakonik kako bi Atenu spasio od snažnih unutarnjih sukoba između bogatih i siromašnih. Taj je dokument starim Atenjanima bio barem onoliko važan koliko je Magna Carta Englezima, no ovaj je zakon mnogo napredniji.
He wasn't just a lawgiver, he was also a poet, defending his reforms. And here he is saying that I freed the land, the black earth, the greatest of the gods, he calls it, extraordinary expression. The greatest of the gods used to be enslaved. He gives freedom to the people who work the earth. And I freed the land of Attica. Attica, the land of Athens. It is the longest papyrus text we have of Greek literature. And that is what changed our understanding of the birth of Greek democracy.
Demokratska sloboda i novi svijet grčkoga grada išli su ruku pod ruku. Da bismo shvatili koliko je to bio radikalan pomak, moramo pogledati što je bilo prije. U stoljećima prije Solonove Atene bilo je velikih urbanih naselja u antičkoj Grčkoj, baš kao što ih je bilo i u Kini i starom Egiptu, ali ni jedno od njih nije bilo grad u današnjem smislu te riječi. Najuspješniji su se razvili u onom što se nekad smatralo svijetom mita. Ovo je Mikena, 120 km od Atene. Postojbina Agamemnona, Helene i Trojanskog rata.
The Greeks of the classical period were brought up on the Homeric epics and their stories of kings of fabulous wealth and power. It was always assumed that those Homeric epics were mere legend, fantasies about a heroic age. That was the assumption until archaeology demonstrated that there is a historical basis in Mycenaean civilization.
Ovo je u svijetu prije 3.500 godina bilo veliko urbano središte. Bilo je dovoljno kuća za smještaj znatnog broja ljudi. No ovo je bila utvrda jednog vladara, a ne zajednica građana. To ne znači da nije bila napredna. Golemi zidovi koji su se uzdizali visoko nad krajolikom bili su tako veliki da su poslije Grci vjerovali kako ih je izgradilo jedno oko čudovište koje je Odisej proslavio, Kiklop. A zapravo su bili pravi pothvat građevinarstva. Najznačajnije postignuće bio je najstariji nadsvođeni krov u Antici. A ipak nije bilo onih ključnih sastojaka koje su poslije povezivali s gradovima poput Atene. Javne zajedničke usluge, javni prostor i javne građevine. Ovo je na posljetku ipak bilo samo veliko naselje s ulicama i kućama natisnutim oko velikog dvora ili kraljevog Megarona. Tisućite godine prije nove ere, Mikena i drugi kraljevski gradovi već su propali. Polako se je počeo razvijati novi tip grčkog naselja. Tijekom 9. i 8. stoljeća prije nove ere, Grci su počeli eksperimentirati sa zajednicama kojima upravljaju sami građani. Taj je model poznat kao polis. Grčki su naseljenici polis odveli daleko od granica svoje domovine. Kad su gradili kolonije, mogli su još hrabrije razmišljati, jer su sve gradili iz početka. Bio je to spektakularan eksperiment u gradogradnji.
This beautiful site is known today by its Roman name of Paestum. But before it was a Roman city, it was a Greek one. Founded by Greek colonists around 600 BC, they gave it the name of Poseidonia, Poseidon's city. Now, it may seem a bit weird to look for a Greek city in Italy, but the south of Italy and Sicily are full of new cities founded by the Greeks in that period in the 7th, 6th century BC when they were experimenting with new ideas of what a city-state, a polis, might be. And it's maybe in this site, better than anywhere else, that you can see the elements that go to make up a polis.
Kako bismo doznali što je revolucionarno u planiranju ovoga grada, došao sam ovamo s kolegicom s Cambridgea Tizianom D'Angelo.
Tiziana, can you give me an idea of how formal was it creating a new Greek colony, a new Greek city?
Well, it was a gradual process, but the colonists arrived here and they had a clear idea of what they needed to build their city. And they had a set of priorities, and so they were starting what was the main priority. The main priority was public space.
Poznato u grčkom kao agora, ovo je bio maštovit odmak, po kojem su se nova grčka naselja više od ičeg drugog razlikovala od Mikene. U srcu polisa nije bila kraljeva palača, nego otvoreno sastajalište građana.
We are basically entering the southern border of the Agora. And the Agora was huge, so it extended there for 10 hectares.
Oh, wow. So not just this, 10 hectares is absolutely gigantic. So public space is really important in the city.
It was the first thing that they were very concerned about.
Yeah.
So they arrived here and they sort of saved this large square. And they said, okay, this is it. And then we'll build everything around it.
Yeah. So this is for the demos. This is for the people. And then individuals can have their houses further away.
Yes, west and east of the Agora. But we don't touch this space.
Ukupno je ovdašnji javni prostor zajedno sa svetištima bio veličine 8 nogometnih igrališta, a to je četvrtina površine grada. Agora ovoga polisa stavila je stanovnike u središte nove vrste naselja. Naselja kojim upravljaju sami građani, grada u današnjem smislu te riječi. Ovdje su se okupljali politi, građani radi razmjene robe i ideja, kupnje i prodaje, ali i radi međusobnih razgovora. Agora dolazi od grčke riječi agoreuo, govorim. Ideja javnog prostora kao mjesta za razgovor možda djeluje bezazleno, ali iz razgovora se rađa politička diskusija, a iz političke diskusije se rađa politika. Agora i politički pristup koji je s njom došao postali su jednako popularni u helenskoj matici kao i u kolonijama kao što su Poseidonija ili Paestum. 900. godine prije naše ere nije bilo ni jednog polisa u Grčkoj. 600. ih je bilo na stotine. U doba osnivanja Paestuma, Atena je bila samo jedan od polisa središnje Grčke, ali se brzo razvijala. Ponajprije se njezina agora razvijala, ne samo po svojoj veličini, nego i ulozi. Malo poslije 600. godine prije nove ere, politika agore stubokom se promijenila. Katalizator te promjene bila je Solonova reforma vlasti, kako je opisuje Aristotel.
His great revolution, his seisachtheia, his shaking up of everything. And here we have Solon talking about how he gives freedom to the people of Attica. He liberates them from shameful slavery, doulien aeikia, and makes them free citizens. The laws say no one who is born in Attica can be turned into a slave. There's no more slavery for debt. And the constitution then gives them political rights. And without that, there is no such thing as democracy. Solon, back in 594 BC, legislated the instrument to create freedom and democracy. He gave them an ecclesia, an assembly, where they had a vote, and where they had the freedom to speak. That freedom of speech is fundamental for democracy.
Solonove reforme nisu bile savršene. Žene i strani robovi nisu mogli biti građani. Ali ipak su stvorile ideju narodne vlasti, koja je svoj vrhunac doživjela u Ateni 5. stoljeća, kad su građani muškog spola glasali o gotovo svim odlukama. O njima se raspravljalo s pogledom na Akropolu, u srcu atenske demokracije na brežuljku Pnix. Jedan od najvećih poznavatelja ovoga mjesta je moj stari prijatelj John Papadopoulos, koji ga proučava već 30 godina.
We get a great view of the Acropolis from this spot, don't we? Mm-hmm. And I guess down there we've got the Agora, and that's where so much of democracy happens. Mm-hmm. And yet this is an even more important spot for democracy, isn't it?
This is the iconic spot. This is where the assembly of male citizens that constitute the Athenian democracy, this is where they met, this is where they made all of their decisions. And it's just here that we have the orator's platform. Mm-hmm. And this is very important. This is where the orator stood. And in order to make your voice heard, you had to shout above a quorum of a minimum of 6,000 citizens.
6,000 is an enormous number. You're filling this entire space, aren't you? And they sent people down into the Agora with ropes, literally to rope them in. They had red paint on the ropes so you could see who was, you know, loitering around. You fill the place till it's full. By definition, you've got a lot of poor people there. You couldn't ignore the will of the poorest people in the society. And that is, of course, one major reason why the democracy expanded.
S vremenom se nije širila samo u Ateni, nego i diljem svijeta.
Do you think the numbers we have in Barnet and Camden are adequate?
You've got more police.
Straightforward
on the street.
Question. Answer the question.
Yes.
Answer the question.
Ask
yes.
A sensible right. Question, okay. Dumbo. Yes.
Here we go again.
Yes.
Water. Here we go again.
Demokracija je živa i zdrava u suvremenim gradovima današnjice. A jedno od mjesta koje s ponosom nosi tu štafetu je London.
Yes or no? Did you say it was going to be free?
I urge you to get up on the cable car.
I've been on the cable car, Mr. Mayor, but I...
Sustav je to u kojem političari moraju podnijeti i dobro i zlo. Najveći zagovornik stare Atene u ovoj prijestolnici, gradonačelnik Johnson, nije iznimka. No Atenjani bi ovu verziju demokracije smatrali pitomom. Građani nisu mnogo toga prepuštali svojim političarima i imali su mnogo veća prava od toga da ih samo smijene.
I want you to imagine you're in the PNIX, that you're an orator on the Beamer.
Yes.
You haven't got a mic at all.
I know. It would have been very difficult. And of course, the Athenians had the inexpressible pleasure of being able, when they were fed up with people, to vote to ostracize them. Can
Absolutely.
You imagine the impact on you as the humble person of Athens? You're never going to be one of these guys, but you can send them to Bulgaria or wherever for a long time. And it must have been a fantastically powerful thing. I think we should bring it back.
I'm not going to say anything or comment on that.
No, stari se Atenjani nisu šalili. Nisu samo imali pravo istirati one koji prijete njihovoj demokraciji.
So what's going on here? We've got a stele, a long piece of marble with a long inscription down the bottom, and then an image up above of a woman crowning a seated man.
Well, it's a celebration of democracy. What we see here is a woman who was the personification of democracy, mm-hmm. crowning a seated gentleman who is a representation of the demos, of the people. So we have the story both in image and in word.
The long inscription says that anyone who attempts to overthrow the democracy, anybody who wants may murder them. They may kill them with impunity and there will be no prosecution.
Atena je ponosno branila svoj demokratski status. Čak i danas u Ateni možete naći tragove toga kako je ta vizionarska vlast koju su Atenjani stvorili nadišla svoje suparnike.
Kalimera.
How are you? Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Do you have ancient coins? Archaea numismata.
Yes, we have. Yeah.
Oh, terrific. Oh, brilliant. Brilliant. And here how much?
€2. Yes. Thank
you. You've made me a happy man. I have to say, I really am pleased to have my own Athenian owl here. €2 is a small price to pay for this beauty. Of course, it's not an original Athenian owl. It's just a modern copy. But symbolically, this is what the wealth of Athens was all about. They made these coins, which they always stamped with the owl of Athena, the goddess of wisdom, with the silver from the mines at Laurion. And it's the lucky strike of one particular year, 493 BC, when the state makes a profit of 100 talents. What to do with this? Their first idea, split it up between the citizens of Athens. It would have worked out at 10 drachma a head. And the great politician Themistocles says, no, 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 invest, invest, invest. With those 100 talents, we can build 100 ships.
Themistocles je bio državnik Churchillovske važnosti za demokratsku Atenu. Shvatio je da mora građane uvjeriti u potrebu jačanja mornarice radi obrane ne samo atenske demokracije, nego i njezinih strateških interesa. Kao i Churchill, Themistocles je bio velik govornik. Nije bila mala stvar nagovoriti atenske glasače da se odreknu gotovine i ulože u pomorsku snagu. Nadzor nad morem i trgovina koja je usto išla potaknuli su razvoj najviše napučenog sredozemnog grada. Ovo je replika Triere, atenskog bojnog broda. Građena je prema originalnim klesanim prikazima. Duga je 35 metara i ima 3 reda vesala. U svoje doba bila je vrhunac pomorske tehnologije. Sa 170 veslača ovakva je lađa morala nadmudriti neprijatelja. Trebalo je malo vježbe i umijeća da bi se veslači uigrali. mogli su posve okrenuti smjer unutar 70 metara, što su samo dvije duljine broda. Oštar kljun bio je njegovo smrtonosno oružje. Počasni zapovjednik broda, kapetan Panos iz suvremene grčke mornarice, objašnjava nam njegovo djelovanje.
Used all the oarsmen during the battles in order to give strength when the ram was hitting the other vessels.
So the ram is a really important part of the ship. This is the true weapon of the ship, isn't it?
Correct.
And what you want to do is get up the maximum speed so that bronze ram goes right into the side.
Correct. The oarsmen, they were free men, something that a lot of people don't know.
Because, of course, historically, rowing ships have often been rowed by slaves, often chained to the oars. It was a brutal and horrible thing to do. And it must have been actually quite unpleasant rowing in a ship like this.
It was unpleasant, but the fact that those men were free citizens, they were not slaves, and that's why they gave their best.
Atenska mornarica, širenje grada i sloboda građana postali su neraskidivo vezani.
The investment of the profits of the silver mines at Lorien in building up a new navy had enormous consequences for the development of Athens. On the one hand, it made Athens a great naval power and led to victories, but it also had deep political implications. The people who pulled the oars were Athenian citizens, but above all, they were the poor citizens of Athens, and that meant that their voice really mattered in politics. They voted to send themselves into battle.
480. prije nove ere, Perzija je prodrla u Grčku. Sad će se pokazati može li se država građana oduprijeti tako moćnom carstvu. Atenski se vođa odlučio na velik rizik. Proročanstvo je Atenjanima reklo neka se pouzdaju u svoje drvene zidove. Temistoklo je to protumačio kao atensku mornaricu. Umjesto da svojnicima brani grad, napustit će Atenu i povući postrojbe na brodove koji su bili usidreni kod Salamine. Prema grčkom povjesničaru Herodotu, Perzijanaca je bilo četverostruko više od Grka. No, kako je pao mrak, majstor taktike Temistoklo poslao je Perzijancima glasnika, koji je dao naslutiti da je Temistoklo spreman promijeniti stranu. Da bi Perzijanci sačuvali položaj dok su se pregovori nastavljali cijelu noć, morali su veslati unatrag. U zoru su Perzijanci bili posve iscrpljeni. Temistoklo je napao i uništio neprijatelja. Premda je Atena bila razorena do temelja i stara Akropola uništena, atenski narod i njihov revolucionarni sustav vladanja izvojevali su pobjedu u ratu. Sad je trebalo izvojevati mir i preobraziti svoj dom od običnog grčkog polisa u najraskošniji grad antike. Kako bismo shvatili Salaminu kao prijelomnu točku, treba pogledati taj kraj s vrha brežuljka Muza.
So we're looking out here on the heart of Athenian naval power, aren't we?
Oh, this is the most magic spot for Athenian history and topography. Right in front of us, we have that crescent moon-shaped harbor, and that is Phaleron. And it was there that the harbor was during the Battle of Salamis. But because Phaleron was too open and too exposed, at or shortly after 480, under the inspired leadership of Themistocles, in order to protect the harbor, decided to move the main harbor from Phaleron to the three different harbors of Piraeus. And there's that one modern skyscraper in the middle. One harbour is to the left of that. One harbour is more or less there. Mm-hmm. And the main harbour, Kantharos, is to the right.
Drveni zidovi Atene, njezina legendarna flota, sada su čuvani ovim slavnim zidinama, zastrašujućim kamenim utvrdama visokim 20 metara i dugim 6 kilometara. Zapravo su opasivale put od Atene do Falerona i Pireja, te štitile vezu s morem i buduću veličinu demokratske Atene kao pomorske sile. Preobrazile su Atenu u grad dotad neviđene veličine, spojen sa sustavom luka koji ga je pretvorio u glavno trgovačko središte na Egejskom moru.
The modern Piraeus is an enormous ferry port, but it's in exactly the position of the ancient Piraeus, and it's this gigantic port that is the secret of the commercial success of ancient Athens.
Zajedno s teško stečenom političkom slobodom došla je i ekonomska sloboda. Atenska pomorska moć značila je da trgovačka mornarica može trgovati s kim želi i tako donositi golema bogatstva i robu s cijelog Sredozemlja i šire. Dijelovi drevnih lučkih utvrda vidljivi su i danas. No što je još dojmljivije, ekipa arheologa iz Državne agencije za podvodnu arheologiju i Danskog instituta u Ateni otkrila je ključni element vrhunskog pomorskog statusa Atene u 5. stoljeću prije nove ere. Temelje brodskih spremišta u luci Zea.
What we have here is an artistic reconstruction of the Zea harbor, and this is exactly the point that we are standing right now, and this is one of the two fortification towers that would block the entrance of the harbor.
So right here, going across the
exactly,
mouth of the harbor.
Exactly right. One tower would have been here, the other one on the other side, and by using a chain, they would block the entrance because they wouldn't like anybody coming in and having access in their triremes. This harbor complex would have been almost 110,000 square feet. You would have space for 196 shipsets.
Temistoklo nije samo potaknuo stvaranje velike mornarice. Nagovorio je građane da pokrenu i projekt javne infrastrukture koji je bio bez premca u antičkom svijetu.
When Themistocles developed this area and created his new system of ports, he built a great wall around it, linked it up to the Acropolis. You can see the trace of the long walls, which are followed by modern streets. But he also created a residential quarter. And he brought in a famous architect, a certain Hippodamus of Miletus, to lay out this new residential quarter for him.
Hipodam je bio slavan po svojim radikalnim idejama o tome kako bi ljudi trebali živjeti u njegovim novim gradovima. Neki ga smatraju ocem suvremenog urbanizma. Nije mu se sviđala zbrka starih naselja i htio je nametnuti novi red u planiranju Grčke. Njegova je vizija bila i utopijska i demokratska. U suvremenoj je Ateni teško pojmiti kako je izgledao Hipodamov grad. No na jednom mjestu se to može. U sjevernoj Grčkoj, 200 km od bugarske granice, nalaze se ostaci drevnog grada Olinta. To je najljepši sačuvani primjer plana grčkog grada iz klasičnog razdoblja. Na južnoj strani nalazišta stoji ranije naselje iz 6. stoljeća prije nove ere. Stoji tamo razasutim nakupinama kuća. Zatim, 430. prije nove ere, vidimo razmjere revolucije koja se dogodila. Novo je naselje planirano matematičkom preciznošću. Duge ravne ulice dijele jednake blokove od po 10 kuća, koje su sve istih dimenzija. Jasne granice tog rastera sprečavale su razmirice među susjedima. Jer je to bilo društvo u kojem je vladao zakon i kuće jednakih veličina simbolizirale su ravnopravnost građana. Temistoklova gradnja Pireja poslije bitke kod Salamine stvorila je mehanizam ne samo ekonomskog razvoja, nego i poticaja mlade demokracije. Raster ulica kod Pireja pružao se prema starom gradu i Atena je ulazila u novu fazu, zlatno doba grada. Ključ uspjeha bio je savez jedinstvenih i raznolikih gradova s Atenom na čelu.
Athens' victory over the Persians led to an explosion of growth. The Persians may have been defeated, but they were still a real menace to the Greeks. And what Athens does is to form an alliance of all the cities threatened by the Persians. A couple of hundred cities sign up to a great naval alliance. The Athenians led the alliance, but they also set it up in a way that proved very advantageous to themselves. They said to their allies, well, either you provide ships to add to our navy, or you give us cash. And progressively, as the cash came in, the navy got bigger and stronger, and it became harder and harder for the other allies to do anything but pay tribute to Athens. By 460, the Persians had been driven right out of the Aegean. There wasn't a single Greek city left threatened by the Persians. And at that point, it becomes slightly less important for the Athenians to put their navy out. And they find other ways of spending their money.
The city of Athena jača na temeljima svoje pomorske pobjede i moći. Gotovo istodobno počinje s gradnjom i Akropola se gradi sredstvima dobivenim zahvaljujući velikom pomorskom savezu. Grad sada slobodno može ostvariti svoj urbani ideal. 440. godina prije nove ere, pod novim dinamičnim vođom Periklom, raskošni program gradnje počinje punom parom. Premda iz aristokratske obitelji, Periklo je bio populist i odvešće atensku demokraciju u još radikalnijem smjeru. Pod njegovim vodstvom siromasi neće samo smjeti biti porotnici, nego će primati i obilnu naknadu za svoj rad. Čak je uveo i poticaje da im omogući odlazak u kazalište. Spomenici na Akropoli osmišljeni su kako bi obični Atenjani bili ponosni na postignuća svoje demokracije. Premda je Partenon najslavnija građevina, pogledati li malo bolje, moći ćete odgonetnuti tragove koje su ostavili stari Atenjani i doznati što su smatrali da je razlog važnosti njihova grada.
It's interesting, isn't it? How all these tourists come flooding through and they've got eyes only for the Parthenon. They all know that this is the monument to see on the Acropolis. And they don't even pause to look at this one down here.
Propileji možda i izgledaju samo kao ulaz u Akropolu, ali John ima zanimljivu novu teoriju. Ako ima pravo, turisti propuštaju nešto monumentalno.
What's really remarkable, and this has been an enigma for a long time, was why did the architect Nesicles in 437 BC change the orientation by almost 40 degrees?
Well, that way.
Out there. It used to point out towards the Hill of the Muses and towards Phaleron.
Yeah.
Whereas now he changed it. And nobody could quite figure out what that was all about. It's so elegantly simple, and it typifies what the Athenians were all about. Upon exiting the Acropolis, upon exiting the Propylaea, Salamis is in your face. Mnesicles captured for eternity. The watershed event that defined Athens.
I drugdje na Akropoli stoje znakovi ljudske priče iza tih spomenika. Otkrivaju duh otvorenosti koji će Atenu učiniti središtem sredozemnog svijeta.
Of course, the big names involved in putting up these wonderful temples, people like Phidias or Mnesicles, they were probably Athenian citizens. But what about the workmen who did all the detailed work?
Well, this is in fact very interesting because we actually have inscriptions that give accounts, a list of all the workmen and what exactly they did.
Ovaj čudesni povijesni dokument izložen u muzeju Akropole popis je imena svih radnika koji su gradili Erechtheion, zajedno s radnim mjestom, mjestom podrijetla i kod mnogih društvenim statusom.
I love the fact that you know the names of each and every carpenter who worked here, the stonemasons, like the guys who carved the fluting. It's quite specific, not who made the columns, but who did the little channels down. And there's this guy called Simeas, who has a group of four slaves, and they were working explicitly on the fourth column, which must be 1, 2, 3, 4. That's Simeas at work. Brilliant fluting.
Look at the Erechtheion, one of the great buildings of ancient Athens. Of the 86 builders, sculptors of the Erechtheion who we've identified, 40 were metics, resident aliens. I think 26 were slaves and the rest of it were free volunteers. So in other words, the overwhelming majority were either slaves or, and the great biggest category, were foreigners. It was built by the Poles, as it were. It was built by the immigrant labor from what was then the equivalent of Albania, or wherever it happened to be.
Erechtheion dokumentira spremnost Atene da prihvati energiju i talent ako je to na korist cijeloga grada. Bilo je to otvorenost koja ide zajedno s demokracijom. Kako je raslo bogatstvo Pireja i njegovih trgovaca metika, tako se je cestovni sustav prilagođavao sve većim količinama robe kojom je trebalo opskrbljivati sve brojnije stanovništvo. Suvremena željeznička veza od stare Agore do današnjeg Pireja prati cestu koja je Atenu povezivala s lukom u antičko doba, i to nije slučajnost. Tehnologija se promijenila, ali nacrt infrastrukture koji su odredili Atenjani u 5. stoljeću ostao je isti. Nova prometna veza značila je da su tada kao i danas Atenjani mogli na Agori kupovati robu iz cijeloga svijeta. Otvoreni grad znači svjetsku trgovinu, dičio se Periklo u 5. stoljeću prije nove ere. Zbog važnosti našeg grada, ovamo pritječu proizvodi iz cijeloga svijeta. A mi imamo tu sreću da s jednako poznatim zadovoljstvom uživamo i u robi proizvedenoj ovdje i u robi drugih naroda.
We know from contemporary descriptions just how rich the Agora was and just what a wide range of goods you could buy there. There's a lovely passage here that I'm going to quote you from a comic poet, and he says you can buy pretty well anything in Athens. It comes from all over the world. Then Syracuse gives us cheese and well-fed pigs. Sails come from Egypt, and this paper too. Incense from Syria. In Paphlagonia grows the almond grove. The elephant sends its teeth from Africa's sands. Phoenicia sends us dates across the billows. And Carthage, carpets rich and well-stuffed pillows.
Uz tako živu trgovinu u gradu i oko njega, atenska je vlada odredila strog sustav utega i mjera, kako nitko ne bi bio zakinut u kupnji. U demokraciji je vladavina zakona važna i imenovani su javni službenici koji su pazili da svi oblici svakodnevnog života protječu slobodno, pravedno i čisto.
So this drain, John, is this an original feature?
Oh, very much so. This is actually one of the most important parts of the agora. This is the great drain. In order for the agora to become an agora, you had to have water management.
Zdenci su donosili pitku vodu u Atenu, a veliki odvod odnosio je višak van, sprečavao poplave i odnosio otpad.
So the Athenians really cared about keeping their city clean. And it's not just having drains, but of course they have a board of officials who are responsible for it.
Oh, yes, indeed. The so-called astinomoi. And these were the people responsible for keeping the city clean. And asti, the first part of the word, is the word for the city, nomoi being rules, laws, etc. So these were the people who kept the drains flowing, who kept the city clean, and they were also responsible for the coproforoi.
The coproforoi would mean literally shit carriers.
Exactly. Yes? And there are very clear prescribed rules and regulations as to where and how far from the city walls you could take the human waste. It's all part and parcel of managing this great city.
That's wonderful. The city of hygiene.
The city of hygiene.
Atenska demokratska vlada nije samo osnovala institucije koje omogućuju da Velegrad funkcionira. Odredila je kakav treba biti polis u Grčkoj. A to je mjerilo nastalo traženjem naroda, narodnom vlašću, demokracijom. Bilo je to mjerilo ne samo za staru Atenu, nego i za gradove budućnosti. Sažeo ga je jedan od najvećih atenskih vođa, Periklo, a njegove riječi nadahnuće su našim vođama današnjice.
A spirit of freedom governs our conduct, not only in public affairs, but also in managing the small tensions of everyday life, where we show no animosity at our neighbor's choice of pleasures, nor cast aspersions that may hurt, even if they do not harm. Now, that is what we're all about. That's London. That's the idea that you let people get on with their lives, that you don't have any prejudices on grounds of race or gender or sexuality or whatever, and you welcome and you tolerate. And that's what they believed in, and that's the ideal we articulate today.
A ta je tolerancija dovela do valjda najvećeg postignuća koje smo baštinili od Atene. U Ateni politička sloboda i slobodna trgovina išle su ruku pod ruku, ali Periklo je shvaćao da za pravi uspjeh grada trebaju ideje, sloboda misli. Ovo je suvremena Atenska akademija, ali ona priziva u sjećanje velike filozofske škole stare Atene, kao što je Platonova akademija. Atenski slobodarski duh značio je da je grad privlačio najveće mislioce tada znanog svijeta, koji su se poveli za Sokratovim i Platonovim primjerom. Što više, upravo je najbolji Platonov učenik Aristotel zabilježio Atenski ustav, njezinu Politeju, dokument koji nam je i omogućio jedinstveni uvid u funkcioniranje stare Atene. Bio je to Solonov zakonik koji je stvorio vezu između slobode i grada, te prvi odredio prava građana. A uskoro se pokazalo koliko je Atena jedinstvena, jer uspjeh donosi i suparništvo. Kako je splasnula prijetnja Perzijanaca, tako je otpočeo dug niz ratova s drugom grčkom državom, Spartom.
These wonderful pieces are copies of sculptures from the Acropolis in Athens. Athens was full of sculptures, images, works of art, monuments. That's what Athens was about. Here we've got the tyrant slayers, Harmodius and Aristogeiton. The originals stood in the Agora as symbols of democracy. These were the people who drove out tyrants. By contrast, Sparta is an almost image-free zone. One of the rare exceptions is this guy here, who's supposed to be the Spartan king, Leonidas, the king who commanded the 300 who met their death at the gates of Thermopylae. Sparta was in so many ways the polar opposite of Athens. It was the opposite of all the ideals which Solon stood for, that idea that if you were born in the territory, you should always be free. In Sparta, by contrast, there was a whole population of serfs, they called them helots, who were generation after generation bound to work for the landholding elite, the Spartiates, like Leonidas. They had no laws, no coinage, not very fond of trade. They didn't really like immigrants. In fact, once a year, they ritually drove out all foreigners. It was called the xenilasia, the driving out of foreigners. And as a consequence, Sparta wasn't much to write home about as a city. At least compared to Athens, Sparta seemed to be just a collection of villages. There was one thing these Spartans did better than anyone else, and that was warfare. From the earliest age, these Spartiates were trained in the arts of war. They knew better than anyone else in Greece how to defend their land and how to ravage other people's land. And when they did so, nobody could stand up to them.
U slučaju da Spartanci prodru na Atiku, Atenjani bi mogli preživjeti bez njezinog ratarskog kraja, jer je grad većinu hrane već uvozio kroz Pirej. Periklo je znao da se u doba krize Atenjani mogu povući iza dugih zidova produljenog grada. Ali ta je naoko dobro osmišljena obrambena strategija imala temeljnu pogrešku.
The Kerameikos here is the biggest graveyard of ancient Athens. And it was near here, when they were excavating a new metro line, just back there, that they made an extraordinary discovery. Among the individual burials, there was an enormous pit full of skeletons thrown in ram-jam without any ceremony, over 100 in number. They must be victims of the Great Plague. The Great Plague was the great flaw in Pericles' strategy. Pericles thought he could survive Spartan invasion by gathering the whole population within the long walls. It was, in fact, an effective strategy, but it had a big downside. And the downside was if you cram people into the same space, they spread disease. A terrifying plague broke out, and we know about it in great detail because the historian Thucydides was one of its victims. And he tells us with medical precision how the plague was.
Dr. Manolis Papagrigorakis analizirao je nove dokaze o tome kako su žrtve pomrle.
Manolis Papagrigorakis has come with one of the skeletons he's studying. This is the head of a young girl.
11 years old.
Are you certain she suffered from the plague?
Yes.
How do you know?
Έχουμε κάνει ανάλυση DNA από τον πολφό των δοντιών που ήταν από τους σκελετούς που ήταν μέσα στο λάκκο. Η ανάλυση έδειξε από τρία διαφορετικά δόντια, από τρεις διαφορετικούς σκελετούς, ότι το αίτιο ήταν το βακτήριο της σαλμονέλα σε τέρικα τύφη με σύμπτωμα τον τυφοειδή πυρετό.
So, what are the symptoms of typhoid fever? How does someone die?
Το κύριο σύμπτωμα ήταν ο υψηλός πυρετός. Γι' αυτό το λόγο οι ασθενείς πηγαίνανε στις πηγές στην Αθήνα για να δροσιστούν, για να πέσει ο πυρετός και έτσι έγινε η διασπορά της μόλυνσης σε όλους τους Αθηναίους.
Nažalost je najveća žrtva te pošasti bio sam atenski vođa Periklo. podlegao je vlastitoj strategiji. Vjera u Atensku pomorsku utvrdu i u sustav opskrbe vodom, diku Atenske javne infrastrukture, nanijela je strašan udarac gradu. No ideja koju je zastupao Periklo i njegov grad živi dalje.
I think that that ideal of freedom is something we need to stick up for. We do in our city freedom of speech, freedom of association. These things are contested now. They are not accepted everywhere in the world. These are not trivial values. They are incarnated here in London, just as they were in ancient Athens, and we need to stick up for them.
Demokratske vrijednosti koje su bile simbol drevnog grada, naposljetku su se ipak raspale. A tu konačnu propast Atene nisu izazvali ni tifus ni Spartanci. Gotovo 500 km sjeverno od Atene bila je još jedna grčka država. Ovo je Pela, domovina Filipa II. I njegova sina Aleksandra Velikog.
Pela was the new capital of the Macedonian kingdom that defeated Athens. The defeat by Sparta knocked Athens back, but did not bring her down. Her empire briefly revived. It was the defeat by Philip of Macedon at the Battle of Chaeronea that ended Athens' chances of being an imperial power.
Makedonsko carstvo omogućilo je gradnju takvih razmjera da se Atena doimala sićušnom. Umjesto uskih ulica s ravnopravnim stanovanjem, tu su se gradile velike avenije i raskošne palače, ukrašene razmetljivim mozaicima. No, u smislu funkcioniranja grada slijedili su primjer Atene u gradnji javnih prostora, sustava opskrbe vodom i javnih građevina. S druge strane Sredozemlja, još je jedan grad država gledao Atenu s divljenjem. Atenjani su odredili nov standard urbanog življenja, ali i mnogo će veće carstvo stvoriti prvi svjetski velegrad, prema tadašnjim mjerilima. A to će carstvo proizaći iz polisa, ali ne grčkog, već talijanskog. Njegovo ime na grčkom znači snaga, Rome, Rim.